You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hey everybody, it's Ken Reed here. Welcome to TV Guidance Counselor and this special bonus episode this week. If you are a regular listener of the show, you know that sometimes I have the opportunity to talk to multiple cool people in one week. I know, I can't believe it. And this week was no exception. There is a brand new documentary that is out this week on video on demand called United We Fan, directed by Michael Sparaga, and it is wonderful. If you are a fan of this show, you will love this documentary. It tells the story of fan campaigns that saved television shows. So it is right in the sweet spot for this show. And the sort of star of this movie, this documentary, is Dorothy Swanson, who founded a organization called the Viewers of Quality Television, which used to give out awards and the Q Awards. Excuse me. And it is a fascinating movie. If you've ever been a fan of a show, if you've ever been upset about the cancellation of a show, or if you just like human stories, this is a great, great movie. I had the opportunity this week to talk to Michael and to talk to Dorothy, and it was a fascinating conversation. I think you will enjoy the conversation very much. Also, for my American listeners, I hope you had a good Thanksgiving last week and that you have recovered fully. If not, hey, this is an extra little hour for you to sit down and listen to TV Guidance Counselor while you are in recovery from having to deal with your family. But as we head into the holiday season and all that, and also, you know, this show is sort of a perfect example of gratitude in that I wanted to thank Dorothy because she saved shows that I loved. And I mentioned this at the end here, Designing Women and various other shows. And It really is sort of amazing how hard they had to work to do that in the pre-internet, pre-millennium age. So I think you'll love this. If you are listening to the show for the first time because either you're a fan of the United We Fan documentary, which you don't have to save, it is on video on demand now, or of Dorothy, or you just stumbled on this. Every week I have a guest on. We usually look through an old issue of TV Guide and talk about what we would have watched that week. Occasionally I chat with people where we don't necessarily crack open a TV Guide, but we sort of talk about all those things in that realm. And this is one of those episodes, but we have brand new episodes every week. Speaking of gratitude, thanks again to everyone who contributes to the Patreon. I know that my tiers of gifts are not fantastic. If there are things you would like me to do in order to get you to contribute to the Patreon, or if you are currently a contributor and there are things you would like, I am more than happy to hear your requests and see what I can do about them. You can go to patreon.com/TV Guidance Counselor, and you can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or ken@icanread.com, which is my stand-up comedy page. There is also a merchandise page on there where if you don't want to contribute to the Patreon, but you want to contribute something to the show and get something out of it, there are pins and shirts and all kinds of stuff on there if you would like that. There is also a schedule of my stand-up comedy shows, as well as any live editions of TV Guidance Counselor that we're doing in the future, and all that fun stuff. So with no further ado, please sit back, relax, and enjoy this bonus episode of TV Guidance Counselor with the director of the United We Fan documentary, Michael Sparaga, and the star of United We Fan, VQT's Dorothy Swanson.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Live via satellite here, we have Dorothy Swanson and Michael Sparaga from the United We Fan documentary. How are you guys doing?
Very well.
Very good.
Thank you.
Great.
You guys are in separate states here. We're bridging three states.
Wow.
It's almost like it's like Farm Aid for this show.
Yeah.
So before, and I have a lot of questions for Dorothy, but starting with you, Michael, what was it about this story that made you want to do a documentary about it?
I just love grassroots democracy. I love feel-good stories. I love television. I love television so much that when I was 13, I wrote a letter to try and save a show. It was always something I kept my eye on over the years. And it's I just always knew that I was going to make this as a film or a show. I just think it's such a wonderful thing that people do to keep the characters and the stories they love on television, to fight for the community of people that they love the show with. And I can't understate how, overstate how important television is in my life, and that without the efforts of people like Dorothy and other people like that, that television just wouldn't be as good. Television is shaped by the people that have fought to show people their short-sightedness about what was working and what wasn't, what was represented on each show, and that pushes everybody to make shows better.
Yeah, absolutely. What was the show that you wrote a letter to save when you were 13?
Well, you'll probably know it, but very few people do. It's a show called Crime Story, and I...
Oh, yeah.
I remember that.
I love that show.
Dennis Farina.
Oh,
Michael Dennis Mann's best TV work.
By far. And it was on during the same time as Miami Vice. I remember I always tell people, it's like, first of all, like, what's the difference? Why don't you like Miami Vice so much? It's like, it's not that I don't like Miami Vice. I just don't think Miami Vice, after a few seasons, was really pushing the envelope the way Crime Story was, where it was serialized, which was very rare back in, you know, the late 80s.
Absolutely.
If it was a Dallas or a Dynasty, you know? And the people that were on the show, Kevin Spacey came to the show, Julia Roberts came to the show, all these amazing guest stars. But it was just... you could feel the show. And when I started to read later how important Sopranos was to Goodfellas, Crime Story was to Goodfellas, and then Sopranos, and how they're saying like this was just a really important show. But when you watch TV by yourself in a small town, I was watching this Niagara Falls. I was the only person my age watching it. I didn't think I was part of a community. I think I was part of that, you know, person sitting by himself trying to tell his friends to stay up later than they're allowed to be awake to watch a show. And then when I saw in the paper it was being, likely wouldn't come back, and that here was a place for you to write letters, and thinking like, oh my gosh, so other people watch this show too. You know, it never really occurred to me that other people watch it. And then writing that letter and then waiting and keeping my eye on the newspaper to see if the show would come back, and then seeing it came back and thinking, like, oh, thank God somebody alerted somebody in Niagara Falls newspaper to publish that address. Like, how important a local newspaper was putting that address out there. So local fans, and Dorothy will speak a lot about this, I'm sure. It's like, you don't have to just be like, if I don't get the letter in New York Times, then what's the use? What does Niagara Falls, Ontario, Canada really matter to the letter writing campaign to save this show? And it did matter. The letters then obviously came from all over and save that show. And it's I felt like I was part of a community, and I was 13. I really didn't know what democracy was outside of what I was being taught. I didn't know how my vote would ever count. I was 5 years away from voting. It was a real special thing. And Crime Story was just, I bought the DVDs as soon as they came. I still, they're in my office.
I'm looking at mine. Looking at mine right now.
Beautiful. And the way they put those DVDs, they really, they got it right, and they got all the music rights, which is crazy because it all takes place in the 60s, and the music is phenomenal.
Yeah, that show I always describe to people as Mad Men Miami Vice.
Yep.
Which is
oh, yeah.
Kind of the best
That's
way
a good way of describing it.
But the you've touched on a bunch of things here that I talk about this show all the time, that those of us that grew up sort of pre-millennium, mm-hmm. where we had no real way of finding our fan group.
Yeah.
And... the phrase I always use is we were watching TV alone together.
Yep.
We just didn't quite know it yet.
Yep.
And when you met people who shared this passion for this show, you knew you were friends.
Yep.
And your anecdote about finding the address in the newspaper leads me to my first question for Dorothy, which is your first show that you saved or had a part in saving was Cagney and Lacey.
Right.
And the first person you wrote to, I believe, was Steve Brown.
Yeah,
who was one of the producers.
He was a
writer. How did you find his address in the pre-internet age?
Okay, let me try to remember that. Well, of course, his name was in the credits, and the episode I had just watched that probably inspired that first letter was outstanding. How did I get the address? You know, I don't remember. Maybe at that time, newspaper. Well, you know, maybe TV Guide published those addresses, networks and studios. Or did I send it directly to CBS and they found Steve Brown? You know, it was a guessing game, partly.
Yeah.
Then Maybe I sent it to Steve Brown in care of Cagney and Lacey, care of CB. I don't remember. I knew it was Orion Television, and I'm sure TV Guide was a conduit for that.
But I mean, you had to hunt for it. There was some detective work there.
Well, yeah, it wasn't just going on the net and finding it. No, it wasn't instant.
Which is kind of, yeah, I mean, that makes your story even more amazing. And I don't know if Michael will agree, but, you know, watching the documentary, to my eyes, this, although there's a lot of people featured and a lot of shows featured, this is kind of Dorothy's story.
Yes. Oh, no, it was doing the research for this film and going show by show, where I made my chart. I'm big on making spreadsheets where it's like the name of the show, the name of the production company, the people that made it, the name of the fan activist. I call them fan activists. And as I did the research, just Dorothy's name just kept coming up. Either it was a very popular name, Dorothy Swanson, or it was the same Dorothy Swanson. And so that led me to Dorothy's book, which I think I've probably read her book 8 times. And as far as going back to it, I've probably gone back to it 200 times just for getting pieces of information as I needed it. I just thought it was just this incredible story. Everybody else in the film, as you know, is they saved the one show. And some of them became world famous. Like the Trimbles obviously are world famous for saving a show. But most didn't do it for multiple shows. And nobody else ever became a professional fan activist. I mean, that's what Dorothy was. Dorothy... And it's in the film where I think you were saving television shows, and she has that pause, and she's like, the deserving ones. And I love that. Like, just a great, great
line.
Well,
the ones that were worth the effort, because back then, as you said, it was an effort to sit down, write a letter, put it in an envelope, address the envelope, put a stamp on it, get it into the mail, after you, of course, struggled to find the address. So I think each letter counted for so much more at that time because of the effort that it took. It took a determined fan to do all
Absolutely.
That.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
It was more impressive, sort of, that you were able to pull together this network of people, because then you went so far as you actually started an organization to do this,
yeah.
you know,
yeah.
from
yeah.
Called the VQT. And you had an award show. And just the thing I identified with immediately was, you know, as someone who's doing this podcast out of a little room in Boston that feels a million miles away from Hollywood and New York and all my favorite TV shows,
mm-hmm.
I've been lucky enough to, you know, get to interact with people and have people guest on the show who have made and been a part of shows that have just formed, you know, been so important to me.
Yeah.
And when the footage of the VQT award show, you end up doing the same thing. And in fact, some of the people who've won awards are some of the very same people I'm talking about, like Julia Duffy,
yeah.
who I've had on the show. Or so you were able to go from being in Michigan writing letters to actually affecting these people's lives and meeting them.
Sounds amazing, doesn't it? I mean, that part, strangely, was not an effort. It just happened. It just grew, and it became a matter of keeping up with the demand to be brought
yeah.
together and to be that community and to continue to care about what we called at that time the quality shows. Sometimes I think now it's become a bit commonplace, and
oh, yeah.
people might they would think, well, any show can be saved, but we had to have, well, we called it the three P's: people, the press, and the producer. Like for example, in the case of Frank's Place, a lovely, lovely half-hour
Tim
show with Tim Reed.
No,
I'm going to ask you for Michael the name of the producer of that. Hugh.
Hugh. Yeah, Langdon.
Hugh. What was his name?
It started with an L. Did
it was,
like
it was
Langdon?
Hugh something. He
yeah.
wasn't interested. He bailed, and there was no point after that.
Right.
We lost him, and so that's a third of the draw, so you need the press also.
Yeah.
And the thing about Cagney and Lacey was the press would not let it go, and it was on in reruns all that
yeah.
summer of 83,
83, yeah.
And it climbed ever so slowly but steadily to number one in the ratings. And I knew then that it had to come back. I mean, it just had to, because the people were there watching it, and the press just would not let up. And so the powers that be did the smart thing and brought it back.
Yeah, I mean, a couple things on that, too. I mean, the press at the time, I think, probably had a lot more sway in that there was less of it.
Yep.
You had sort of marquee, you know, you had things like TV Guide, which at the time was the single largest print run publication in the world.
Yep.
That if you could get to them, if you could get something published in there, you would have an impact. And it's very different now in that sort of everybody has a voice and can distribute things, but it's almost a sea of things. It's hard to get through those gatekeepers that don't exist.
Right.
So you did have a thing you could approach. And, you know, when you got Cagney and Lacey back on the air, it was on the cover of TV Guide. You know, it said, you know, show has been saved by popular demand was one of the headlines on the very cover of the magazine.
Yeah. And VQT was really the only game in town at a time when it was powerful. There was no ATX festival. There was no Comic-Con. People who made television shows never got to meet unless they would do a mall tour or a baseball tournament like the way Happy Days did.
Right.
You know, they really didn't get a chance to, you know.
The General Lee at this car show.
Exactly. Or the Batmobile would come out. And those were the things where, you know, you could meet people. But they weren't talking the way VQT was intellectually. Like, I called them a book club for television. They weren't talking intellectually. They were just there as just crazed fans. And again, that's another line in this film where someone says they were fans, but they weren't fan-ish. And I think what was great is they were trying to have the same conversations people were having about Wuthering Heights or, you know, Bronte's work, but they were putting television producers and writers in the space of big authors the way they were being discussed. And the big authors, of course, like, oh my God, television producers would be like, this is great. I'm so happy this is how I'm thinking about television, even though it's marketed and I just have to wait for ratings. So now here I am, I can talk intellectually about how I'm actually thinking about my shows.
And to my view, and it sounds like, Dorothy, you probably didn't approach it this way consciously, but in the 80s, when the VQT was talking about this quality television, it was pre sort of cable really making their own shows,
right,
where people look at the HBOs and the AMCs. And it was post when people looked at sort of quality TV as something that the BBC made, that PBS aired. So you were taking these network sort of pop culture shows and really treating them like art.
Well, and there were so many at that time. There was Hill Street Blues. There was St. Elsewhere. There, I could go on and on, and so could you. Add to my list that there was such a plethora of quality shows to choose from. I now, on my DVR, record two network shows regularly.
Mm-hmm.
One,
what are they?
One is Law & Order, still Law & Order, Special Victims Unit. And the other is, I've just forgotten it. What might that be, Michael? Anyway, most of my viewing is on cable.
I can guess it. Can I take a guess? I think it's
sure.
This Is Us. This Is Us.
No, it's not.
What?
Good guess, though.
I did not. No, I've not become fond of that show.
Speechless?
I don't remember, but what Special Victims Unit, it's just always there. Oh, I know. It's Blue Bloods on CBS with Tom Selleck. Yeah.
Nice.
And it's all characterization to me, and plus the stories. I still am drawn to the same thing.
Yep.
Memorable characters and well-told stories, and that's what I look for.
That's so great to hear.
And it's not, and it's not even genre-specific. Like, there's a big portion that another, you know, after Cagney and Lacey, another show that you guys really had a hand in was Designing Women, which a great comedy.
Oh, yes, it was. But there again, characters. And the stories, the writing. I mean, it was just one well-told story after another, and unlike any so-called sitcom. I mean, it wasn't a situation comedy. It was a character comedy.
True.
Absolutely, and it tackled things like AIDS. And,
as was Fraiser.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
And, you know, and this is sort of a question for both of you, because you may have slightly different perspectives on this, and it's sort of an underlying theme in the documentary, but this really was a movement that was spearheaded by women.
Yes.
And when we look at the first couple shows, or the sort of biggest wins, they're very... unusually for the time, women-specific shows with strong female characters like Cagney and Lacey, like Designing Women, which there weren't a lot of on television at the time. Is that something you realize now?
Well, it was groundbreaking then. And and we were drawn to that as well.
For sure.
Like, we hadn't seen anything like that before.
Yeah, and I think you were fighting for your representation. I think we've seen that over and over again, at least in this doc, is... people are fighting for their own representation on screen, for the most part.
But at the time, I didn't know that. I didn't realize that. That wasn't what was driving my passion. It was not representation. It was. It just happened to be about two women in Cagney and Lacey, and about four women in Designing Women.
True, but you're talking also.
I'm not conscious of the fact that was it about representation. I didn't think about that.
No, but you were watching shows that women were creating and starring
and
were the driving force. No wonder it appealed to you.
It must be a factor. It must, yeah.
You know,
yeah, that sort of makes it so much more pure.
Now that you say it, I can see it.
Yeah, and in our film, we have Kaylee fighting for a person of interest. I mean, literally fighting for her representation of the LGBTQ community and fair representation and decent treatment of those characters. And we saw that with Chuck fans who were just fighting. They felt nerdy and... you know, they're like, Chuck was a nerd, and I'm a nerd, and I, you know, or the people who fought for Star Trek who are fighting for their vision of a future where hopefully the world doesn't explode, you know, and here's a show where the Russians are our friends. It's always, it's not necessarily gender or sexual representation so much as even if it's the representation of the way you think and the way you hope the world can be, or the way you could be accepted personally
anyway. I might have thought at the time... it was recognition.
Yeah.
I don't think the word representation was in my vocabulary then, but it was a recognition of that.
Yeah.
So it was pretty much the same thing, yes.
Yeah, or even like a show like Frank's Place, which is a show that's very, very black. It's very African-American experience.
Yeah.
And the fish out of water aspect there is that you have a lawyer from Providence going to New Orleans, which is a very different kind of black culture.
Yeah.
And there's sort of no white entry point to that show. It's a very unusual, especially for the time, representation, a very unusual thing to identify with.
It was Hugh Wilson. And that's who it was. Hugh Wilson.
Hugh Wilson from WKRP.
Right, of course. I said Langdon. Right. I knew it was in at the end.
Yes. And Hugh also did the famous Teddy Z, which was another show that was sort of a bait and switch, which ended up being a show about Alex Rocco, who's, you know, a 60-year-old guy, which you'd never get a show greenlit about now.
You might. You know, so you might on Netflix. You might. That's
true.
Advertising doesn't matter as much. You're starting to see the people, it's certainly at subscriber-based things, push away from the 18 to 49. We need advertisers on this. They're starting to look at who can pay $10 to $12 a month off their credit card, not think about ever canceling it and just leave it there, whether they're watching it or not. And exactly.
Same. Me too. Yeah. I don't even know what I'm signed up for.
Yeah. I was like, oh, what? I already have this. It's like, you just keep paying for it because it's the way you pay for it. It was different. You know, until credit cards did these payments, you used to have to physically either go to a place and pay it or write a check and mail it in to pay it every monthly. And so you had to seriously consider it. Now you don't even know it's being deducted, and subscriber services are really, you know, benefiting from that. And they'll, like I said, they were making content for a whole bunch of different people now, because you don't need 20 million people to watch it either.
That's very convenient.
Oh, you couldn't even get
very convenient.
Yeah. Yeah.
You couldn't even get 20 million people to watch it. When I look at the shows that got canceled due to low ratings, they would be the number one show on television now, just from a numbers standpoint.
Doesn't that just, I know, I think back.
It's crazy. It's crazy. I mean, but that leads me to another question for Dorothy, in that you managed to sort of teach yourself how ratings worked.
Right.
Like, that's not a thing that people at the time understood, you know, to even be able to find them and know, you know, what a 60 share means, what this means. Do you remember how you kind of tried to educate yourself on that so you could talk the language of these people?
Well, it just became a part of the job, if you will. There were a lot of things that I had to learn, and ratings was one of them. And I remember asking David Poltrack, then with CBS, in a limo on the way to tape some talk show, and Cagney and Lacey had just been picked up again, and I said, what share does it have to stay on the air? He said a 22 share.
Oh my gosh.
And I thought, okay. I mean, that seemed doable at the time. Now,
oh my gosh.
Of course, yeah, a 22 share.
That's insane.
That was a long time ago.
And that means, for people that don't know, 22% of the televisions in America on are watching that show, basically.
That's incredible. Yeah. Mm-hmm. The Super Bowl barely gets that. It's incredible. Yeah. Fans, it's amazing, with so little knowledge of the business, they fight for shows that are usually business decisions, and they're fighting for them for all sorts of other reasons. I mean, there's a little bit more information out there as you as a fan really want to look up what owning both sides is, or, you know, what a streaming service or network is sort of looking for, so understand the business side of things. But that's not always the case when people are, you know, fighting for shows. Rarely is. I don't think they're thinking it's really important that these people who work and make this show and star in the show can continue to put gas in their car and put their kids through school. Like, they're saving jobs. They're making major corporations change their decision. And then they're shaping culture. They're shaping popular culture by fighting for the show. It's just incredible. I can't stop thinking and talking about it. I find even after making the film, there are layers and layers that aren't explored.
Yeah, I mean, it's to your point when we first started, it's sort of a less obvious portrayal of grassroots political movements in a lot of ways, but one that's sort of easier to understand, because I think everybody at some point has been a fan of something that was in danger of going away, and they felt sort of like they didn't have any say or control over that product that's so important to them.
Yeah.
You know, whether it be a TV show or whether it be, you know, a Coke Zero or, you know, whatever it is, everyone sort of has that thing. And I wonder, and this is for either of you, do you think that now it's almost too easy to access the people making these shows, access the people being on these shows, and that the fan reaction is almost too instantaneous, that it almost affects the work too much?
There's an interesting scene in deleted scenes that we have some creators, I wish it was in the film, which is the answer kind of that question, where we have people like Tom Fontana talking about, did I ever really interact with these people? And, you know, Rob Thomas, more recent ones. And honestly, I think there is access, but there are a lot who have turned themselves off from access as well. And not because fans can be, certain fans, it can be difficult potentially, and they want what they want, and they think that they should have it. It's because they already get enough notes from the studio. They already get enough notes from a lot of other things. And fans will always fight for things that they think they want. Like in this deleted scene, Rob Thomas says, fans would never have voted for Ned Stark to have his head lopped off, you know? And that's a great line, because what he's saying is, it's your medicine are the things that you don't want. And sometimes showrunners make mistakes, but often it's all part of a greater thing that's happening on that show, that you're supposed to be mad at the television. You're supposed to want to, like, rip the cord out of the wall when your favorite character does something or dies or something that you don't approve of. And it's just, I don't know. I don't think it's easier if the person on the other end doesn't want to make themselves available to you. It's not any easier. And it's difficult. Actually, people are surrounded by more people now.
That's true. Is there a show that you couldn't save that's like your number one you wish you could have saved? Or that you would have liked to have seen an extra season of?
Oh, China Beach comes to mind.
Right. Oh, good show.
There were certainly more stories to tell there.
Yeah.
What's another one we lost, Michael?
Frank's Place, you always said, was your biggest regret.
Well, yes. Frank's Place, but yeah.
Our World. Did you save a show?
And yes.
Didn't end up actually
world.
Coming back.
Oh yes, yeah. we essentially did. That was ready to come on to PBS, but it just never worked out. I'm not sure exactly why, but Linda Ellerbee told us at our very first convention in McLean, Virginia, in 1987, that we saved the show, and thank you, and pretty soon you'll be seeing it on PBS. But it just, all the pieces never came together.
So we did
our job right. Lots of letters were generated. The press was all over it. The president of whatever the PBS station in New York was at the time called me, and he was excited. He said to me, "Do you know what you have done?" And I guess I didn't fully. So we were very disappointed that it did not come back after all. So,
but that's fascinating. Because it wasn't just the three major networks. That's a PBS show, which people don't necessarily think of.
No, it was ABC.
Ah, and it was coming back on PBS, in theory.
Yes.
Which you see a lot now.
Exactly.
You're seeing a lot now. It's amazing that what year to make this documentary. I say to people, it's like one show was a big year. If you could save a single show, if fans can rise up and make a major broadcaster or streaming service change their decision, that's a huge thing. So, two is a phenomenal year, but we've had seven or eight this year safe, and it's incredible.
But it's different, Michael. It's different because they get picked up by so many other outlets that where the rating can be lower and still be successful.
And I think they're also looking for subscribers. I think there's a different way.
Right.
It's not even ratings. You're saying to yourself, okay, we're trying to make a competitive thing with Netflix. This is CBS is saying to themselves, okay, we're making a streaming service and we now want people who get CBS for free, if they have an antenna, to start paying $10 a month for it. So that's around Netflix. So how do we do it? So let's go out and find a fan group that will automatically pay to have more episodes. It's funny that it goes back to Star Trek. So there's Star Trek being the anchor for All Access, which clearly is an incredible anchor because they have three or four Star Trek shows now probably getting ready for CBS All Access, the Picard reboot, the Star Trek Below Deck. There's another spinoff of Discovery coming. And then, of course, it was The Good Wife. They had the new show, The Good Fight. They put that there. So they're looking for fans that are already connected. So all you have to do is Google fan campaigns. And I'm sure network executives are doing this because every single show in this documentary, outside of Chuck, which will come back in some capacity, I'm sure, is coming back. Every single one. Cagney and Lacey, Designing Women. The Roswell, the 4400 was just talked about recently. Everything. And I wouldn't be surprised to see down the line something for Person of Interest. If the 7 million people that were still watching that show after it was canceled when they were burning it off in the summer, they'll look back at a number of 7 million fans. And if they keep up that noise online, some network executive is going to be like, maybe there's 450,000 subscribers. It'll throw this on their credit card, not think about it anymore.
But there's another factor, Michael and Ken. There's another factor. After a certain amount of time, the actors and the producers and the writers scatter.
Yep.
And maybe somebody would put that show together again, but would it be the same? Would it be the same show that the fans were so passionate about? And I think Person of Interest is a good example of that. Both actresses are very busy.
Well, not anymore. Sarah's show just ended. Sarah's show was canceled last week. Reverie. Yeah, she's had another canceled show. And Amy only does 12 episodes. Right now you have people who can be on multiple shows because they're not doing 26 a year. Most networks are only now doing 13. So you're having people who are stars on multiple shows, which, again, we have never seen before.
The TV season also isn't September to May anymore.
Oh, God, no.
Right.
So
no.
People can shoot these. They can shoot these things whenever they want. It used to be, you know, they might shoot a movie in the summer, but they're locked in during the year. And that also isn't a factor.
Yep. Absolutely. It's a very different world. Television has changed the most. Features really haven't. You still have to look for a release date. It has to be over a certain length. You're seeing a little bit more of television influence in a way. Is you're seeing that on the movies because you're saying to yourself, Marvel is essentially a TV show. I keep telling people, it's like Marvel movies are a TV show. These are just different episodes that come two or three times a year. That's it. You know, television is that powerful right now. The numbers being drawn are so powerful. And I don't know. I think television is better than it's ever been. There's way too much of it. I can't even watch. If my best friends wrote down their top five shows, the variance between those, and I just said, okay, I'll watch just those. I still couldn't even watch all of those. It's just a different world in television, and a great world if you love television.
Do you guys, I know Dorothy, you said you DVR two shows, but is
no,
there...
Network shows. No.
Network shows, yeah.
There are a lot of other shows I DVR.
Are there any comfort shows?
You know.
Or stream, yeah.
There's so many. You can get a lot on your plate now.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
We have access to sort of everything we ever wanted. Are there any sort of old shows or classic shows that you revisit that are like a comfort show for you that when you just want to kick back, you'll throw on one of the streaming services?
Well, do you mean something new or something I've seen before?
Something you've seen before.
Like, a lot of people do that and they get so much enjoyment out of it, but I don't.
Really?
I pretty much watch the new shows. Or, you know, the old shows that produce new episodes, sure. But do I go back and revisit Designing Women or St. Elsewhere or China Beach or Cagney and Lacey even? I don't. I'm not sure.
Michael, do you watch old shows?
I do. I actually watch them to bring that nostalgic feeling back. It's a feeling I kind of like especially when there's a big announcement of a show coming onto a streaming service. I remember when Friends was announced as coming on, how excited I was, how big the purchase was, even how much Netflix paid for it. So when that came on, I watched all 10 seasons. And I was surprised I was able to sort of fit that into my life, because I think a lot of what I'm watching now for the most part is hour long. It's, you know, a lot of the adult content is hour long. So I was actually happy to have something that, especially a sitcom that was on a broadcast, you're talking 22 minutes in length. So that's a lunch. I could sit and eat lunch and watch a show. And I did that with Fraiser as well. And to just watch those shows and just, I'm still laughing. And you know what amazes me is my nephews and nieces who are watching Friends love Friends. And they're like, none of these characters have cell phones until the very end. The computers are the size of like a Volvo. And they're not laughing at it. They're not pointing and laughing because it's the relationships. It's the characters. And that's, you know, to me, what makes something so timeless is I laugh as hard. It's hard to laugh twice at a joke told. You know, if you hear a joke twice, it's hard to get that big belly laugh the second time. Frasier makes me big belly laugh the 19th time I'm watching an episode. Same with Friends. And there's something about that laugh that was a little bit more innocent before television got as dark as it is now. And it's great. And I love it because it's that way. But I used to have to go to the movies to get that darkness. You know, I used to have to wait for Scorsese to release Goodfellas or Casino or something to go and get that vibe. But you get that vibe 24. So you're seeing like Gotham is a horribly dark show, wonderfully dark show, too. And I love that show. Again, serialized. But there's something about an innocent time when jokes were clean and just so wonderful. So, yeah, I do watch those shows to make myself feel good and feel different, too.
Yeah, I mean, I do the same thing with Newhart. Yeah. That's kind of one of my shows like that.
Yeah.
But I think there's something to be said, too, for the ritual of it.
Yeah.
The knowing that you have that at the same time every day or the same time every week, and it's something to look forward to, and it's reliable. And and for me, that's one of the reasons it hurts us so much when a show does get canceled, because we now have an hour, a half hour of our week that we used to look forward to that is kind of empty now. And so it sort of hurts to have that sort of hole.
You touched on that. That's very true, because fans aren't fighting for streaming shows. Very, 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 very rarely. We saw Sense8 have a big one, and again, that was representation of the LGBTQ community that was already organized. But when you dump a whole show all at once, it's not a week to week. You don't build fandom the same way. It can't be a water cooler show. My friends who like Stranger Things and I like Stranger Things, we don't talk about each and every single episode the way you're seeing with Game of Thrones still. And so you can't build a fandom that's that obsessive. They're just so used to so much content coming on and off that if Stranger Things disappeared after a couple of years because of some sort of like the creators left or the staff left, Netflix would just move on and the fans would move on. They'd just be like, okay, Netflix, what's next? You know, like that's it.
Right. Well, they'd also have it too. Like you could always go back and watch the old episodes.
True.
Whereas when we were all growing up, you know, when Cagney and Lacey was off the air, you might never see it again.
Yep.
Even the old episodes.
Yep.
So, it was even worse. This question you may or may not want to answer. Was there ever a show you saved that maybe you wished you hadn't? Like it went in a direction.
Oh, no.
It went in a direction that you were like, okay.
No.
Because there are shows that I like Freaks and Geeks is an example, right, and My So-Called Life, that I loved. And then after they were canceled and I read the plans for the second seasons, I was almost relieved that they were canceled.
Oh, wow,
okay,
that's funny.
There is one. There is one. Beauty and the Beast.
Oh, that really changed. Right. Yeah, that changed.
Yes, it did. And we had a lot of those fans at our convention out in L.A. at that time. And they, you know, we were promised that the show was coming back as we would know it and as we loved it, and there was a huge following. There were fans that wanted Vincent at any price, and there were those who wanted Catherine to be treated well, and she wasn't. It was horrible what they did to her in the second season, and yes, that does come to mind. I was very disappointed.
It was a
nasty ending. It was a nasty ending for a beloved character.
Well, there was no beauty anymore. The show was called Beauty and the Beast, and there was no beauty. It would be like Simon and Simon with just one Simon. You know,
and you didn't know which one it was.
Yeah.
I don't know how long. I don't remember how long it went on, but I didn't watch it for long.
No,
I think it was another season and a half.
Yeah, just one more season.
Yeah, Ron Perlman I had on over the summer, and we discussed some of that at length about the changes in that show.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
And even he was like, "This is just, I don't know." The documentary is out, streaming it on VOD now. For when this episode's released, and I cannot recommend it enough. I also want to mention that it was produced by SuperChannel, right, Michael?
Yeah, SuperChannel out of Canada were great partners. They were there for development and the production. It's been wonderful.
And I wanted to bring them up because they saved one of my favorite shows, SCTV. They actually brought it back for SCTV's final season in 85, which would not have happened without Sumo. So they did this as well.
It's a national treasure. I mean, we have John Candy on our dollar bill, right? That's how... No, I'm just kidding. We don't.
You should.
It's funny. I could convince usually some Americans of that. It's like, oh, yeah, well, he deserves to be there. And Wayne Gretzky's on our $10 bill. It's like, oh, fantastic. Yeah, that makes sense. but no, we have prime ministers and queens on our bills. But yeah, I mean, you feel sometimes like you owe the people that brought a show back, and in a way, it's not really the case. They sort of owe you as well for pointing out to them what they had on their hands, for showing them, because yes, some shows come back and they're gone pretty quickly. They get that little half season. It didn't work out. There was a reason. And then you get something like Cagney and Lacey or Designing Women or Star Trek, where the fans showed the executives they were onto something spectacular, and they go on to run for multiple seasons and win awards.
And Quantum Leap, too.
Quantum Leap. And that's a show that changed in its third season as well. Actually, that's one of the shows that I beyond love. Having Scott Bakula come in and talk so lovingly of Dorothy. And this is a man who's very, very busy. You know, that's what I love about this film, is the easiest interviews I've ever had with big, busy people was this film. Because obviously the fans want to talk about what they did. But when I started to reach out and say, like, well, Scott even remember VQT and the people who fought for his show. He's been on so many other shows since. It was 2 seconds after a cold call that I'm hearing back. Absolutely. He loves Dorothy, loves VQT, remembers all that. Because this is at a time for these people when they felt like failures. That's something I didn't quite realize until interviewing a bunch of them. That
it's like being fired.
Yeah, you're being fired, and it's a slow death. It's a slow death. You've been told you're canceled, and then all of a sudden this grassroots group of people saves your show, and you're like, you know what? That's way more important than having a 22 share for us. This is, as artists, you hope you're touching people enough, and if you could touch people such a way that without your prodding them, they get together and fight to save your storytelling and your jobs, it was so easy. They just said yes. Everyone in this movie said yes. And all very big people, they just wanted to have an opportunity to thank the fans for what they did.
Yeah, and I mean, I think to your point too, like, they don't know what a 22 share means numbers wise, but I think for a lot of these people, they make this show and then they don't necessarily know how people react to it, or, you know, they don't talk to people who watch it because they're so involved in the business. So, you know, one of the most moving parts of the documentary is speaking of Fraiser when Kelsey Grammer's acceptance speech.
Yeah.
And it's amazing. And, you know, these people who gave you so much joy and the shows that you loved enough to put your time and your blood, sweat, and tears into saving them, you realize it means almost just as much to them, and you get to sort of give back to them.
That was very rewarding. That was a very rewarding part of the whole thing.
Yay. You know what, for me, the most rewarding part, it was showing it to Dorothy. Having Dorothy behind me at the world premiere in Toronto and listening to Dorothy, she was almost like a Wheel of Fortune crowd, remember, where they'd just be, and you could hear everything. So I could hear everything coming out of Dorothy behind me. And my ears, I'd seen the movie a lot, you know, I made it, so my ears were tuned backwards towards Dorothy. And at the very end, when she put her hand on my shoulder and just said, thank you. That's when people say, like, well, what was the best part of your year? I'm like, that was the best part of my decade. You have no clue how best that is to be able to tell an incredible story, take someone else's story. We were with Dorothy for just a couple of days, but a lot of talking in advance of that and a lot of working afterwards to get this archival material from Dorothy and other people from DQT. But then to show it to Dorothy and have her appreciate it and then have the people, the stars that have seen it that are in the film say, this really does justice to how important television is in people's lives, how important these people were specifically in my life. And I hope that this draws people, you know, I hope people watch this and then go onto iTunes and rent Quantum Leap Episode 1, Season 1, you know, go to St. Elsewhere, rent Cagney and Lacey, you know, that's my hope.
Where do you find those?
Oh, you can just go to iTunes.
Yeah, they're on iTunes. Yeah, you could buy it. TV. Yep. Amazon Prime.
Yep. Absolutely too.
They're all on there.
And that to me is the greatest.
And I want to thank you guys for making this documentary, which I really loved. And Dorothy, for, you know, you saved a lot of shows I loved, including Designing Women, which was a huge one for me.
Right.
Believe it or not, as a punk kid from Boston, Designing Women's actually was a huge show for me.
That's
so
great.
Thank you for all that you've done. And it's been great talking to you guys.
Thank you so much. This was wonderful. Thank you for having us on.
There you go. That's Michael and Dorothy. I could have talked to them all day. What a great chat. Again, great documentary. It's out on video on demand and all the streaming services. It is called United We Fan. Highly recommend that you watch it. It is a great, great watch, and it will also spark you to watch a lot of the shows they talk about. So be prepared to just mark a whole day off your calendar, because once you watch this, you'll probably marathon a bunch of shows that are mentioned on the show. Also, there are a lot of people who are on the shows that they talk about that I've had on this show. So you can go back and look for a lot of those people. I mentioned in this episode, Julie Duffy specifically, because she won a Q Award, but there's a ton. So if you haven't heard those episodes, feel free to go back through the back catalog. If you don't feel like doing that, you can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com and I can kind of tell you which episodes they are. But you also don't have to do that. Wherever you get the show, please subscribe if you haven't already. It is a huge help to getting the word out about the show. If you have a moment and you can rate and review the show, that is also a huge help, and I appreciate it very much. If you don't have a moment, that's fine too. So thanks again, everybody, and we'll see you again next time on a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.